like to call to order the regular meeting of the Perry Municipal Authority, December 2nd, 2019, at 6:15. A roll call, please.
Caldwell.
Here.
Bond.
Here.
Dilbeck. Ahern.
Here.
Marshall.
Here.
White.
Here.
Moore. Wines. Stroh.
Here. I do declare a quorum. We have one item, oh, I'm sorry. Let's do have an invocation. I didn't say invocation here, but I want to do that. Will you guys pray with me, please? Dear Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for this evening. I want to thank you for the opportunity that we had this last week to gather together as families and recognize the thanksgiving that we all are thankful for, the different things, each one of us having a heart that we're so thankful for. And we are all thankful for what you do for us and the guidance and protection that you bestow upon us each and every day. I ask you be with this committee as we perform the business of the city, and that you help us make the right decisions. And I just ask that the decisions we make will be best for the city and glorify your establishment. I pray this in your son's name, Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen.
All right, I'm sorry, council. Item one is the consent agenda. There is one item on the consent agenda this evening.
Motion approved.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Caldwell.
Yes.
Bond.
Yes.
Ahern.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
White.
Yes.
Stroh.
Yes. Item number four, comments from those assembled pertaining to the items on the PMA agenda. Seeing none, item five, proclamation, combination, reports, and inquiries by the governing body. Seeing none, item six, any new business tonight for the PMA? Item seven.
Motion to adjourn. Second.
Roll call, please.
Caldwell.
Yes.
Bond.
Yes.
Ahern.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
White.
Yes.
Stroh.
Yes. Thank you, council. I'd like to call order the regular meeting of the City Council of City of Perry, December 2nd, 2019, at 6:18. Roll call, please.
Caldwell.
Here.
Bond.
Here.
Dilbeck. Ahern.
Here.
Marshall.
Here.
White.
Here.
Morrill. Wines. Stroh.
Here. Thank you. Item one, the consent agenda. We have items A through G to approve, or we can talk about something if you'd like.
Make motion to approve all items listed in the consent agenda, A through G.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Caldwell.
Yes.
Bond.
Yes.
Ahern.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
White.
Yes.
Stroh.
Yes. Thank you. Item number four, comments from those assembled pertaining to the items on the city agenda. Item number five, proclamation, accommodations, reports, and inquiries by the governing body. Seeing none others, I will tell you that we applied for a REAP grant to put the fencing around the water plant. And we received that REAP grant, $30,000. We just got notification for that. So I wanted to bring that to y'all's attention. Pretty excited about that. Any others? City manager's report.
This time of year, we have our street projects that are winding down. Jackson is complete. So we're excited about that. One of those projects that was started and completed this year. We didn't have to roll it over to next year like we have some others in the past. So we're excited about that. Sidewalk project is beginning to shape up very nicely. I think that's something that we're all going to be very proud of. And that's pretty much all I have right now. Any questions? Thank you, council.
Thank you, sir. Okay, let's move on to item number seven. Consider items pertaining to zoning and land use planning. Item A, receive recommendation from the Perry Planning Commission concerning the application filed by 2J's Property LLC and Oklahoma Limited Liability Company with a mailing address of Post Office Box 1069, Pauls Valley, Oklahoma, 73075. The applicant, to rezone certain tracts from their current zoning of C1 Light Commercial Zoning District to C2 General Commercial District, and conduct a site plan review for the construction of a new Sonic drive-in at the following street address, 728 First Street, Perry, Oklahoma, 73077, and with a legal description of tract of land being a part of Lot 8, Block 8, of the original town site of Perry in the city of Perry, Noble County, Oklahoma, more particular described as the following, beginning at the southwest corner of Lot 8, thence north, 00 degrees, 30 feet, 29 inches. Is that right, Bryce?
It, yes, 29 huh? seconds.
Yeah.
Okay, well, it's, I heard that too.
but you can skip the legal.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, if you like, and just go right on down to, well, that's it. I mean, you've identified the,
okay,
the area.
Okay. Is that it?
Yeah.
Okay. So we're receiving a recommendation from the Planning Commission. Sir David?
Yes.
What is the Planning Commission? Derek, would you grab that podium right up here?
On the zoning, they recommended approval as submitted. Then on the next one, there was a little bit of change. So, but on the zoning that you're looking at.
Would you repeat that in front of the podium, please?
Would I what?
Could you come to the podium?
Yes, I'd be glad.
And repeat saying.
There are two issues pertaining to that. Item 7 is just pertaining to the zoning, and that particular piece of property had been zoned C1, and for this use it needs to be C2. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, the Planning Commission saw no problems with that and recommend approval. And I'll talk to you again when we get to item D.
Okay. Council, do we have any questions about item A under 7? Okay, well, let's move on to item B then. Consider approval of the ordinance number 2019-26, amending the zoning from its current zoning of C1 Light Commercial Zoning District to C2 General Commercial District, and approving the site plan for the real property located at 728 for Perry, Oklahoma, 73077, with a legal description of a tract of land being a part of Lot 8, Block 8 of Perry, of the original town site of Perry in the city of Perry, Noble County, blah, blah, blah. All right, so now then, this is considered approval of the recommendations that the Planning Commission has made for us for this piece of property.
I can hop in here. Because I've reviewed the minutes and I've spoke to the folks. This, of course, approves that zoning. Drive-in restaurants aren't permitted by right in a C1. They are permitted by right in a C2, and so that's why he wants C2 zoning. He could have done a use by review in C1, you know, got it approved, but he wanted C2 zoning, which is the less restrictive zoning, and the Planning Commission agreed. The second thing is the site plan is approved as submitted with three variances. One is they were talking about the use of on-site parking for employees, and we have a section 12-230E of the municipal code that in certain instances, if the Planning Commission approves and if the City Council approves, that you can use on-street parking in lieu of on-site parking, okay? And that's what they proposed, and that's what was agreed to by the Planning Commission. And that is for employee parking. When I'm done, just if you need to add something, because I...
Well, no, I was looking for that, and it, I thought it was in part two, but you're talking to the part that I wanted to make sure they understood.
The second thing is the location, the waste dumpsters, in a location is approved by the solid waste contractor. We called Jimmy Davis. He said, anywhere is just perfect for me. We're going to make it easy on them. So he's getting a hold of Mr. Moore, and they're going to get it in a proper location. But the action was in a place as agreed to by the solid waste contractor, and he said they will get that done. The final thing is don't disturb the sidewalk maintained along 8th Street. So those are the three issues. Dave?
Yeah, that's what I wanted to make sure that they were aware of, and I was looking forward in B, but you got it there in A. So
the ordinance, the zoning ordinance as submitted, provides for all of that. And that's what you're being asked to do, approve the ordinance. The recommendation was do approve it, subject to that. If you approve the ordinance, that's what you'll be approving.
Yep. Have we done anything to understand that intersection and people parking on the road and visibility for, like, when the students get out? I know a lot of them come to that intersection specifically there. And is there
when they go to lunch, there's a lot of them that walk from the high school over to Homeland, or they'll walk into Sonic, and, you know, having the parking there.
Right, having cars sitting there kind of concerns me. But
there is, you know, whenever, when the pharmacy built their, when they built that pharmacy, which kind of upset me a little bit, the agreement that came to the Planning Commission and came to the council was that corner area that is all concrete now would be all grass. And that way there would be no parking on the west side of 8th Street for that exact reason. So they could have a clear view of sight of cars coming down Fir. And I remember it was before Larry's time, and I don't even remember who the city manager was at the time, but I remember driving by there and seeing them out there pouring concrete. I run to City Hall and said, someone's got to go for a stop, and that's supposed to be grass. Well, it's too late then. And but they've made accommodations that no one will park there anyway. So, but if you look in the plans under tab 7, there is a pretty good spot kind of towards the back of tab 7. It's better to go to tab 8, maybe come back forward about halfway. I don't know. There is a drawing there. There's a pretty good chunk of concrete along Fir there that no cars could park. So where the sidewalk's going to walk down, there's still going to be a pretty good area there. It appears to me that there could be a you know, people could gather and you know, cross that street without having, you know, their sight impaired by vehicles.
Could I make a comment?
Yes, sir.
In our subdivision ordinance, there is a requirement to not obstruct the view of the sight triangle at intersections. And that is measured from the corner pin of the property 25 feet back along each property line. Within that triangle at an intersection, there are restrictions on what you can put there. And that is so that when a car pulls up and needs to look at oncoming traffic from both directions, they have that 25-foot triangle to facilitate that. I can't tell you for sure that fits, but I believe it does.
On the next page forward, David, there's a set of plans with numbers on it, but I can't read it.
We might have to leave out the two north parking spaces to accommodate that. I don't think they would object if that's what you wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
But we didn't review that specifically.
Yeah.
That's a good point. And leaving two of those spaces out would probably take care of it.
Like I say, on that next page forward, there's a drawing with dimensions and stuff, but it's going to take someone with a whole lot better eyes than I got to be able to determine what those what those numbers are. Any further questions, council? And I did talk to, Larry and Bryce and Dixie and everyone today, City Hall a little bit. If you look at the backside of Sonic where it comes out onto that alley, I don't believe that that alley's in very good condition right there. So we may consider, I don't know, it'd be us or in combination with the contractor or the owner of Sonic, maybe we could do something there to improve that alley just right behind Sonic. It seemed like to me that that alley is really pretty narrow, that when you come out of there coming towards 8th Street, it's really pretty narrow, if I remember that. We want an approval on this item, right, Bryce?
Yeah, it's set out as an ordinance, so.
Okay, yeah.
So can we make that motion to approve that ordinance 2916-26, but with that addition of removing those two northern parking spaces? Is that how we would say it, Dave?
If necessary.
Honoring that 25-foot side triangle,
yeah.
Whatever it takes.
Ensuring that no improvements or cars are parked within the 25-foot
and
side triangle.
We missed that. That's a good observation.
Thank you.
So I'll make that motion.
Yeah.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, roll call, please.
Kohler?
Yes.
Bond?
Yes.
Ahern?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
White?
Yes.
Strong?
Yes. We do not have enough council persons here to pass the emergency this evening. So we will move on to number C, letter C. Consider approval of ordinance number 2019-24 for the City Council of the City of Perry, Oklahoma, amending Chapter 12 of the Perry Municipal Code, the 2018 supplement, by the addition of a new section 12-248 entitled New Manufactured Home Regulations, providing for a definition, procedure, and criteria committee determination and appeals, appropriate zoning district and violations, providing for the amendment of section 12-251 by the addition of the new subsection 17, providing that new manufactured homes are a permitted use in the AG agricultural district, providing for the amendment of section 12-261 by the addition of a new permitted use, providing that the new manufactured homes are permitted in use in the RG residential district, providing for a repeal or savings clause, codification, severability, penalty, and declaring emergency. Sir?
Currently, if you have a mobile home or a manufactured home, you can file an application. There will be you'll have to bring in the abstractor certificate that shows the property owners within a 300-foot radius of the exterior boundary of your property. The city will have to send those folks notices 20 days before a public hearing before the Planning Commission. A notice would be placed in the newspaper 15 days before the hearing before the Planning Commission. The Planning Commission would consider that application as to whether or not that mobile home or manufactured home should be placed on property zoned RG or AG. And then if they make a recommendation to the City Council, either way, the City Council can then approve it. That's our current procedure, and we're not recommending today any changes to that procedure. What we've done is we've provided for a new ordinance. And the new ordinance concerns new manufactured homes. And we define what a new manufactured home is. New means new. Okay, kind of have it defined there, but new means new. And it's got to be, and if you look at the one you have, it says 1,400. Planning Commission has recommended as part of the recommendation that we drop that to 1,200 square feet. But that a new manufactured home could be placed on RG property or on AG property after being reviewed by a committee, a five-person committee, which is made up of the zoning officer, the Planning Commission chairman, David, the city manager, and Craig, or the building official. And they would make sure that these requirements are met, and a manufactured home could be placed in that area. Now, this manufactured home would have to have a sloped roof, and it would have to be consistent with the properties, you know, that are around it. It would have to have a two-car driveway made of a solid surface, either asphalt or concrete. It would have to be installed by a manufactured home installer. There'd have to be concrete block put, around it to, you know, decorative or some sort to make the bolt-in part look appropriate. Have exterior siding similar in appearance as determined by the building official with other site-built single-family dwellings in the area, and could be installed. And that is without providing for all that process that I talked about in the first place. Now, the idea here is to give an opportunity for new housing in the community, without having to go through, you know, $1,000 procedure and 45 days to make a determination as to whether or not you could be here. Somebody could, you know, file an application, bring in what they want, and it could be approved. You know, the purpose of this is, you know, there's complaints, whether they're true or not, that there's not, you know, sufficient inventories of adequate housing in the community. You know, there's, whether it's true or not, that the housing that's available is either not priced correctly or it's not in the condition or in the location where the person would want it. And you know, what we're wanting to do is increase utility accounts for purposes of the city. We have lots of lots that we've torn down buildings on. There's other lots that are vacant lots. Most of them, many of those, are in RG areas. This did go to the Planning Commission and was recommended for approval without one change, and that's that the square footage be dropped to 1,200. So if it's 1,200 square feet, you could have one building, you know, one section, one part of the building that has to be at least 1,200 feet, or you could have two pieces, you know, that are joined together of structure that would have to be at least 1,200 or more to so qualify. We have someone, if this passes, we have someone that's immediately going to take advantage. Is she in the, she's here?
Yes.
She's here today, so that's what we're proposing. David, do you?
Yeah, I'd like to point out one other significant thing to what you're looking at proposing here, or adopting, is that we've made an attempt to separate mobile homes that come in on wheels and metal frames, to separate those from a house that is built just like a stick-built home, brought in on a trailer and set on a foundation. So it wasn't built on the lot, it's built somewhere else and brought in, but it's the same type house you would have if it was built there. Trying to separate mobile homes from that type house. So we think the language in here sufficiently does that. So we'd be allowing by right in these two zoning districts those houses that were built in another location brought in. But we're not changing the rules that pertain to a mobile home.
Now, if this committee does not approve the building permit, they would have a right to appeal that decision to the planning commission, and then ultimately it would come before you. So there are, you know, appeal rights provided in this ordinance too.
So council, let me ask that, mayor, if I may. Should this pass and be approved, and someone in the past has made an application but went through the process that we have currently and was denied, is it possible for them to come back and reapply?
Absolutely, yes.
Would there be certain conditions to that?
Well, there'd be the conditions in the ordinance. Okay. I mean, it would have to be new. I mean, you know, new means new. And it would have to meet the criteria as provided in the ordinance, yes. In fact, any adverse, you know, zoning decision, you know, I mean, you know, can be, you always can reapply, you know. And we don't really have a rule that says that you have to wait a year or something, but, you know, there has to be some change, you know. There should be some, or time is a change too, you know, a difference in time. I mean, you can't keep getting denied and keep filing them. But yes, of course, yeah, we would re-review that. And so the only districts that they would be permitted again, but permitted by right after following that committee recommendation, any appeal, would be AG and RG, which is where they're permitted under the current use by review process. We're thinking that, you know, this may bring, you know, more housing units to the community, and we'll see what happens. One of the reasons we recommended dropping it to 1,200 is because that is, under the definition of manufactured home, that is the largest, if you want to say single wide, you know, the largest structure. We want it to be at least that big. But this is provided without notice to the public. There's not a newspaper publication. There's no letters going out. And the reason is because this kind of housing has improved dramatically. It does have proper wiring. It is manufactured correctly. But we're still going to have, you know, the building official involved in it to ensure safety from everywhere. But, you know, this kind of thing, new product can be delivered for, installed, delivered, maybe for $100,000, right?
Right.
And a new product in town that could be installed for $100,000, you're all in and probably good for 20 or more years. That may be something that spurs some growth in the community. In areas which, at least according to Chris Henderson, if you remember the memo that we did of when we put in the casino, part of that was that it's very, very rare to have new development in residential sections where the property has deteriorated to the point, you know, I mean, that's what you need to spur on, because, and you've got to find, you know, a different type of housing and a different type of price point. But all those lots are so valuable, because to build the infrastructure, to put in the sewer lines, the water lines, in many cases, the driveways, the curbs, the streets, all that, you know, we can't afford that upfront cost, you know. And to date, a developer hasn't come in and said, let me do it for you. And the last one was, you know, the Northern Development. So, you know, we're really talking about trying to develop part of the town where we have so much costly infrastructure in place, but where there are no currently no dwellings.
So I was going to say that, you know, that most of the RG is somewhat the older portion of our town, and there's a lot of houses that have been dilapidated and tore down, and it's just because a lot of the structures are older, and they're just vacant lots there. Like Bryce said, the utilities are already there, and, you know, if someone owns a lot or could pick up one of those lots fairly cheap, this would be a great way to develop them areas.
And Mayor, if I may, this would be a good time to introduce our new code enforcement officer, Brian Henry, back there. Ask him to stop by and in case there are any questions or anything. So, thank you, Brian.
What do you think, Council?
So, because you mentioned single wide, so are some of these still, like, are some manufactured homes still considered single or double wide? I mean,
no, that's really just dimensions, you know. It's really just talking about dimensions. That's probably, you know, that's mobile home talk, you know.
I think they mean single wide, they're not two or more pieces putting together, they're just one piece.
Yeah, I mean, what, like, you're talking about, it's got to be, you know, it's got to be a 1200, it's got to be 60 by 20, you know, or any combination of that to reach the 1200 feet. So it's going to be a decent, it's going to be a decent size structure.
Those homes that they build up there by Garber on 412, that could be considered a single wide because it's one piece.
Well, I think where the confusion is or where the line is kind of drawn for me is a lot of those places that you go to that do sell trailers also have a different version that is called a manufactured home. But we are not going to call that a manufactured home, or we are?
Well, if it has the characteristics, if it meets the definition, if it, you know, and it's defined as, if it meets the National Manufactured Housing Construction and Safety Standards Act of 1974, if it's got the sloped roof, if it's 1,200 square feet, if it has exterior siding that's similar with the property that's going to be put in, if it's installed by a state licensed manufacturer home installer, if it's brand new, it's never been installed before, yeah, that is now going to be permitted after going through this committee to be, you know, to be installed.
But what we will not allow is for them just to come in, take the wheels off of it, and strap it to the ground.
The key here,
it's got to go on like a stem wall foundation.
There you go. That's the key. In my mind, that's the key difference, is that the house we're looking at, we're talking about here, goes on a foundation, a perimeter foundation, as if it was built in place. And it's bolted down. It could be on a slab or a perimeter foundation. The way they do that is on these houses that come in on a trailer, so it kind of looks similar up to that point. They build it in another location, put it on a trailer and bring it in, but they pour two C-shaped stem walls and they drive through the middle, set the house down, bolt it down, pull the trailer out, and then they finish that stem wall with concrete block or poured concrete. So when it's all said and done, it's a house sitting on a stem wall, just like a conventionally built house. I suppose if you brought a double wide in and did all of that same stuff, it would meet this criteria, but that wasn't really the intent. We were trying to separate out a mobile home, because what drives this whole conversation, this whole concern, is in a neighborhood where you have nice homes, some brick on them and all of this, and nicely landscaped, it doesn't matter what this thing you're bringing in looks like. If it looks like a trailer house, it's always going to be a trailer house to these people over here. And they see it, and the people that's going to purchase any of these houses see that as a detriment to the property value. But what we're trying to do is leave those mobile homes that come in on their own wheels and their own frames, leave that as it is, treat them just like they have been. These houses that are built off-site and brought in and set down that are not a mobile home, they're a moved home, built somewhere and moved in, those would be treated like a conventionally built house. Because otherwise, if they were going to build it in place, it meets all the parameters, we would give them a building permit and they could build it there. We're leaving one thing in the code where it does require another set of eyes to come in and look at the application and make the decision that, yeah, it looks appropriate for the neighborhood. Giving more opportunity to evaluate that. But it's not a mobile home. It's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about these houses that might be one piece, might be two or three pieces. I believe your houses.
Ours is three or four.
Three or four.
I'm not sure, but yes, three or four.
Yeah. So they're brought in and hooked together and finished out on site, but the big chunks were built someplace else and brought in on a trailer and set down on a perimeter foundation or a slab, just as if it was built in place. But it's not a mobile home with skirting. Skirting is for mobile homes. This would be different. So that's the main difference, is setting on a perimeter foundation or slab versus a mobile home that would be set on blocks with skirting. That's on a drive-by from a galloping horse. That's the thing you'd notice is different.
Okay. Is that in that Manufactured Homes Act? That definition, is that in that Manufactured Homes Act?
If you go to the definition of manufactured home, it's what you and I would call a trailer house. So that's why this is a new term. This is a Perry, Oklahoma term.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
A new manufactured home is something we've set out by definition as something other than the traditional manufactured home, which has its own wheels and its own frame. That's where we got hung up on this. Back when the original ordinance was written, we were calling these things trailer houses and mobile homes. They changed their terminology to include, to call those manufactured homes. Well, that painted us in a corner because we were trying to address what I've been describing as manufactured homes. The official definition now moved them up into this area. So we're trying again to move out of that so that we treat these types of houses separately, trying to separate them from mobile homes.
So is this what you were originally trying to do, or mm-hmm. was this a new route?
No, this is what we were originally trying to do. Nothing has changed.
Okay.
Yeah, it's about 2,500 square feet, close to 2,600 square feet. It resembles a stick built. I mean, it is a stick built home. It's
right.
Got a wraparound porch on it. Wooden wraparound porch with matching shutters. Sloped roof. It's got all of that. But that's what we were originally trying to get done. Ours was never a double wide. It was always a triple or more. I think the terminology that got confusing was modular versus manufactured. Mm-hmm. I think is kind of where everything got confusing. This house in particular that we kind of set ourselves on doesn't come in modular. It only comes in manufactured, and that's what is in the interior of it, I guess. It's not going to change the way it looks. It's not going to change the way we live in it. This one has, it's got vinyl siding, and it's got brick around the bottom. So it's going to resemble, it's not going to resemble anything where we're putting it because, it's on east boundary. But it'll resemble my mom and dad's house pretty well. And for the most part, it's built a lot like my mom and dad's house.
Okay.
So what stirred this whole thing is she came in and made the application and thought that everything was going to go smoothly, thought we had made provisions for this. Turned out that the terminology didn't fit properly, and we realized our ordinance as written didn't accomplish what we wanted it to accomplish. So her application brought focus to a problem in our code, and we're trying to fix that.
Okay.
And Jennifer, we do appreciate your patience with us.
Oh yeah, no problem. Just living with my parents, so you know, they're at the boomerang all the time, so it's fine. We're okay.
I told Jennifer that her and her husband have kind of pioneered us in a new direction, and I really appreciate that. But although I do want us to pass this ordinance
for Jennifer, I don't want to pass this ordinance just for Jennifer. I want to pass this ordinance because I think it could be a huge help for areas of our town.
It fixes something that was broke.
Yeah.
So on the, my lap, and I will butt out after this. I know I'm keeping you all. So as far as the double wides and stuff, you can still bring those in. You just still have to go through the application process.
Correct.
Okay. You know, I want to make sure that everyone knows, you know, they're all manufactured, okay? Somewhere else, right? They're all manufactured. The mobile homes is a term pre-1976. I mean, it just is. I mean, 1976, they changed it. It's not just that they changed the word. They changed the requirements, the construction, the wiring. They changed it all. But prior to 76, they're called mobile homes. They're called manufactured homes now. And some are better. I think yours is, you know, much more akin to a modular home, you know. But I want to make sure that you know that what we're talking about, you know, are some things. They are going to be bolted down, but they are going to be, I mean, you know, they may go this way. They may come in side by side. You know, if they're in fact bolted down on a perimeter foundation, they're going to cost $100,000 or more.
Right.
I mean, it's going to be that level of housing. No one's going to be able to get in this ordinance for less than $100,000.
Right.
But I don't want anyone here to think that, I mean, it's going to be, they're going to be manufactured homes. I think yours is significantly upgraded from what some of them are. But it's got to meet these code sections. It's got to have these requirements. It's got to be large. It's going to be expensive. But, I mean, you may be able to buy it at Solitaire, right?
To me, a solitaire still comes in on a steel frame and wheels.
Well, I don't even know what it, but it's not restricted to a Garber home.
No.
I mean, it's not restricted to that.
That's what I was getting at, though.
It's got to be set on a perimeter foundation. The definition that's set out here is that it's got to meet those standards, that standard from 1976.
You know, the home that Garrett and Ashley live in?
Mm-hmm.
You know, granted, it's on the wrong side of the street.
Right.
But that's what we're talking about.
Yeah.
If you took that home and put it on the other side of the street, would it matter?
Well, I mean, it's a solitaire.
I'm asking you, would it matter?
Not to me.
Exactly. That's a nice home. It's a very nice home.
I'm telling you.
That's why I'm trying to figure out where the blurred line is. Because to me, that's a solitaire, but it's still pretty nice. And mm-hmm. to him, it still comes in on the trailer, you know? So that's what I want to make sure is there's no blurred lines. I'm in complete favor of what we're talking about here. I know there's lots of different price points, and if we could cover all those price points and make sure that some people that couldn't afford what she's getting could get what they need.
Well, I think they can. Hers is significantly more expensive than at least what was attached to the application. And I want to, that's not public, but you know, but it was, yeah, I mean, it's expensive. I just want to make sure that you know what we're doing. Brian, do you have any comments? I mean,
you guys have done a pretty good job about covering that. A lot of the language that, like, I came into this with was kind of the modular mobile house thing as well, and I think they've done a really good job as far as covering what you would clearly define as, like, a modular home. And you find those not just like in like small town period Oklahoma, but you're starting to see that becoming like a lot of the, I have to choose how I say this, why I should probably stand up, sorry. But like a lower income, like higher value home, does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, something that, you know, Joe Blow down the street may not be able to afford, this is gonna be a healthier alternative for him. And so I think it would be a great asset to this community. Personally.
No, I'm in favor of that. I just wanted to make sure that we could still do the other two if that's what they can do.
Yeah, that hasn't changed.
So we are providing more options here.
Okay. All right.
Item C, counsel.
Mayor, I'll make a motion to approve the ordinance number 2019-24 with that one change from a minimum aggregate size of 1,400 square feet to 1,200 square feet.
Second.
Is there any further discussion? Any more questions? Roll call, please.
Caldwell.
Yes.
Bond.
Yes.
Ahern.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
White.
Yes.
Strada.
Yes. And again, we don't have enough members present tonight to pass the emergency. So if you don't mind, how would we handle this, Bryce? When will this go into effect now that we don't have, we can't pass the emergency? I know.
It'll go into effect 30 days. 30 days after it's published.
And that will be Saturday.
No, 30 days after it's published, whenever
we'll
it's
publish it. Saturday, with that.
30 days after
we'll
Saturday.
Publish it.
Yeah. Now, what you could do is we could put the emergency clauses on the next agenda, okay? Because you have 15 days to publish an ordinance. Well, no, we'd.
Well, I would say go ahead with our.
Yeah, we could publish the ordinance.
Go ahead and publish it, then we could come back and try to pass the
emergency. Pass the emergency, then it's immediately
effective. We've had a couple meetings.
Then it's immediately effective, and you've already published it, so it's.
Because we've had a couple meetings that we haven't been able to get emergencies passed, so. Because I don't want to go another meeting and then.
Well, you can put the emergency on the next agenda, or the next time you meet, whenever you have seven people.
So let's go ahead and publish it, and then we'll do that, too.
Okay.
Is that right, counsel? All right, thank you. All right, let's go on to item number 8. Consider approval of ordinance 2019-23 of the City Council of the City of Perry, Oklahoma, pertaining to the Perry Municipal Airport, amending Chapter 16 of the Perry Municipal Code 2018 supplement entitled Transportation, Article 2, entitled Airport, by the addition of a new section 16-209 entitled Parking Certain Vehicles or Trailers or using any vehicle or any building or other structure as a dwelling within the enclosed fence area of the Perry Municipal Airport, providing for amendment to Chapter 18 of the Perry Municipal Code 2018 supplement entitled Fee Schedule, by the amendment of Section 16-205 entitled Annual Ground Lease Payment of Lots and Rental Fees for Hangars at the Airport, providing for a certain amended fees and new fees for services at the Perry Municipal Airport, providing for repeal or savings codification severability effective date, declaring emergency. Whew. All right, there is quite a few items in this agenda. Bryce, would you like to discuss some of the changes that you have made to this ordinance?
I've just put it through the Derek filter. we changed a little punctuation and nothing of any substance was changed. Enforcement of this subsection rather than this subsection. But you know what this ordinance does is it provides that certain vehicles and certain uses, which is a residential dwelling use, is not permitted on the Perry Municipal Airport. It's going to be policed by the airport manager. Now understand that out at the airport, that's not located within our corporate limits. And there should be a statute that says property that's owned by the city and outside of its corporate limits is still subject to the police power, but they changed that in 2004. The state legislature didn't, they haven't changed it back. We did try to get that changed, but it hasn't been changed back, which means the police can't enforce municipal ordinances out there. So as you see, there's not a penalty clause on here with a fine because they can't right now go out and enforce those. They'd have to kind of enforce a traditional public trespass, which would be filed under state law, you know, out there. But what we're replacing restriction out there on certain types of trailers that really don't belong there, or RVs, or And that's really A, and then B is, you know, you don't use it as sleeping because it's, you know, FAA and it's controlled. But, you know, there may be an instance where somebody does. I'll tell you, up there in the big hangar, there's sleeping quarters up on the second room. I've seen them, you know, and they used to have folks there. And, of course, we used to have the air medics out there in the building. But,
well, let me inject real quick. Yeah. We have a group, which is two or three different spray pilots, agricultural spraying pilots, and they spray from daylight to dark, and they don't live here, and they have travel trailers that they camp out in during the night hours and get up first thing in the morning and go spraying again. You know, that would be at the discretion of the manager, but that would be one use that we would probably allow. Go ahead, sir. I'm sorry.
Yeah, the rest of them just have to do with increases in rental fees out there. You know, we're trying to make the rental fees consistent with similar airports. You know, we have very reasonable jet fuel out there and airplane fuel. That's why we get to sell a lot of it. But we just wanted to make some of these fees consistent with other airports. It provides for a nominal increase in each instance, but we haven't raised these in a long time, in years. Okay, so we don't think any of them will be necessarily objected to. And many of these, some of these, in some of the buildings are already being paid. So we're making it consistent with what, you know, once the big jet left, you know, we started leasing the big hangar space. You know, we didn't have a fee there because that was kind of reserved for the big jet. We also provide for a after-hours call-out fee of $40 if you get called out. Now, that probably won't be necessary when we get self-fueling, and that is coming. We're having that designed right now, so right, that probably won't be required. So this doesn't become effective until January 1st. Of course, you don't have enough votes to pass the emergency, so that's about when it would become effective, too, if you passed it. So.
Council Terrence Fielding is our airport manager. He's here to answer any questions you may have. He was instrumental in putting this all together with Price, and Terrence is here. Should you have any questions?
How many times have you charged someone a $3 for tying down their airplane?
Believe it or not, never. The thing is, if you look through the statutes on it, because it is a public airport, you can charge $3 or whatever you need to charge for an overnight tie down, but by law you have to have 3 spots available for free parking. So usually it's like...
You're not full.
So they really haven't worked. Yeah, that part.
I was just laughing earlier today about that $3.
Yeah, I don't. We have to have at least 3 parking spots that are free, so.
Does council, do you have any questions for Terrence at all?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Collar?
Yes.
Bond?
Yes.
Eichhorn?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
White?
Yes.
Strummer?
Yes. Thank you, council. Item 9, consider approval of ordinance number 2019-27 of the City Council of the City of Perry, Oklahoma, providing for an amendment to Chapter 18 of the Perry Municipal Code 2018 Supplement by the amendment of Section 5-106 entitled Building Permit and Other Fees, providing for new building permits, plan review, inspection, and other fees by the repeal of the current Section 5-106 to the Chapter 18, by the amendment of Section 5-204C, by the amendment of Section 5-306, by the amendment of Section 5-404C, providing for different inspection fee for plumbing, electrical, mechanical inspection, respectively provided. Is that one word?
No.
Okay. For repealing, savings, codification, severability, and penalty, and declaring an emergency. All right, under item nine, under the tab, there's a whole new set of fees that management has come up with for our inspector to charge the city, which in turn we would charge the person seeking permits. This should spark a little discussion.
I'll tell you that these fees and these charges are consistent with what we're being charged, okay, through our professional building official. With that said, I would recommend that you continue this to allow you to spend more time looking at the numbers. One of the numbers, for instance, to put in a hot water tank goes from $10 to $70. And, you know, that might be, although I think we did say $0 for a storm shelter, you know. I think we look at those costs. But, you know, what you can see from looking at this is what the cost is to the city to do a professional job of a review of plans, right? And what it cost us and taking a look at that and passing that forward. But and that's pretty much what we did. Okay, I can't say that we sat down and had a committee meeting and said, you know, what should this be? Well, what we did is we took what we're being charged, and it was easy to do. I think I told you at the last meeting, I just grabbed Okarchi's one because they use the same building official. And I just kind of tailored that to us. So, you know, if you want to talk about it today, I think that's fine. I think that that you should want us to go back and think about some of these. And if in the next 2 weeks you have some thoughts about it, looking at it, please let us know or talk about it right now. But I will tell you that our fees right now are really light. You know, and they in no way capture the, you know, amount of money that we're spending. But, I mean, maybe that's the way it is in government, you know, that there are those costs. And maybe you should pass them on, and maybe not. Certainly a Brahms or a Dollar General or a Sonic or, you know, a school district, you know, those kind of folks would expect perhaps maybe gripe about it, but expect to pay a real review process, particularly considering that they don't pay, you know, drainage fees and floodway fees, and, you know, we don't have exaction amounts because, you know, require fire hydrants. And I mean, you go to a bigger city, Stillwater, Edmond, or Enid, and the amount of fees that you pay in order to get your permit or extensive. This one's really just, you know, kind of a pass-through.
Yeah, we're certainly not trying to prohibit any kind of improvement or any repairs, make it more difficult for folks to do the emergency repair or anything. We're trying to close the gap between what we receive for the permit and what we're currently paying.
But we wanted to show you that. So this is mostly a show you that, you know, and then allow us to work on it some.
So currently, our inspector, the way I've been told, is making $75 an hour. So are these the charges that he's going to start charging us then, instead of the $75 an hour? Because that's what I asked today, and you said this is what we're being charged. So is he not going to work by the hour? He's going to work by the job then?
He works by the hour on certain things like commercial, like the school district, for instance. That was a per hour deal. If it's smaller things like a water heater replacement, then that would be according to that.
So if he comes out to my house and looks at my water heater and says, yeah, Hewitt Plumbing did a good job, I approve it, gets in his truck and leaves in 10 minutes, I'm getting charged $70.
That's the proposal right now.
What do you think, council?
I'd make a motion to table the item till the next meeting to give us a chance to examine some of those more closely.
Second.
Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Kilburn?
Yes.
Bond?
Yes.
Ahern?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
White?
Yes.
Strowler?
Yes, thank you. Consider approval of items pertaining to Camp Tandaco. Items A is consider award of a bid for Camp Tandaco Trail Project to the lowest responsible bidder, CP Intricate Services Incorporated, in the amount of $198,470.60. In your background there, you can see that we received three bids. The highest bid was way higher, $425,000. And they're recommending that we award this bid to the company for $198,000. And through, the way I understood it today was through all the costs that our grant that we received, and after we award this bid, we'll still have somewhere in the neighborhood of $8,500 to $8,700 left.
That's exciting.
On that, some funds left over to, for whatever we have on the tail side to clean up. And we do have a representative here. I'm sorry, from Cowan, the Cowan Group. Does the representative have anything that he would like to say?
What's the name, representative?
The name is Gordon Johnson. Cowan Group Engineering, LLC. Yeah, that's good. We got to get to work on this. We lose the money. You lose the money.
This is merely awarding the bid. Mm-hmm. They'll need to get the bonds in place, and right. That will bring it back. Review all that, bring it back for contract award at the next meeting. But it comes in right. It comes in on the money, so it's just perfect.
Any questions concerning the project, some of you don't know, I'd be glad to answer those.
What do you want to do, council?
I'll make a motion to award the bid to CP Integrated Services in the amount of $198,470.60.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Kilburn?
Yes.
Bond?
Yes.
Ahern?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
White?
Yes.
Strowler?
Yes, thank you. Item B is consider approval of payment of $9,548 to Cowan Group Engineering, LLC for engineering services for the final design, bidding, and construction administration inspection services for the Perry Tandaco Trail Project. This is paying our bills for the engineering and construction inspection.
Motion to approve the invoice.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Kilburn?
Yes.
Bond?
Yes.
Ahern?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
White?
Yes.
Strowler?
Yes. Thank you, council. Item number 11. Consider approval of contractor's application for payment number 4 in the amount of $32,740 in the contractor's application for payment number 5 final in the amount of $7,440 with Utility Technologies Services Incorporated, hence US UTS, hence the amount automated water and electric meter reading system projected and accepted by the project, so long as was installed in accordance with the plans and specification. I'm gonna let Dixie address this item. She had a discussion with me today about all kinds of meter issues,
So I don't want to screw it up, so I'm gonna let Dixie have this discussion with you.
Okay, I didn't know you were gonna do that.
We talked about this last meeting, if y'all remember.
We did talk about something related to the last meeting. As far as these invoices are concerned, I had Will Sheets, the inspector, and Brian Wheatley and Vernon Robbins all review these invoices, and they all agreed that these should be approved. But what, the one thing I wanted to bring up, at the last meeting, whenever we had the additional amounts to pay on the electric meters, I went back and had a discussion with Brian Wheatley about that, because I was still a little bit confused myself, and I knew that we had returned some meters, and we talked about that, but I was wrong and I misled you. The only meters that were returned were water meters. We never have returned any electric meters. And whenever I had the further discussion with him, it did kind of come back to me, the electric meters can never be returned. They are proprietary information put inside those meters when they're built that are specific to Perry. And because of that, they purposely ordered short, because they knew that we were, as we went through the process, we were looking at all the accounts, and some places that had been abandoned for years or different situations, they knew we weren't going to replace meters there because there was no need, because no meter had been used in those locations for maybe a number of years. And we didn't want to install new meters in these locations that had probably no prospect of ever being put into use, because that was a waste of money. So they ordered short knowing that we were going to clear out the accounts and review all of those. And probably we would need to order a few more at the end, but we didn't have that exact count and the exact sizes of the meters, and they wanted to wait until we had that exact to order, because they didn't want to waste money and spend and buy something that couldn't be returned. So that was the reason that we had the bill last time for the additional meters.
Okay, now, is this our final?
Or this is the final on the contract. But because we're having to order a few more and finish up, there, we may be seeing some other bills from them, which will still use the pricing that was in the contract, but it will not be a part of the contract price. But if, you know, for instance, they had a pricing per meter, they'll still be honor those prices, but it'll be in addition to the contract.
Danette, did you ever get your meter? You were talking about you?
That's my water meter, yeah.
Oh, you never have?
Okay. You don't have a water meter? I'll ask.
Yeah. We tried to do it and it wouldn't work.
But you have an electric meter. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, council. Item number 11. What are you going to do with that?
Motion to approve payment.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Collar.
Yes.
Bond.
Yes.
Ahern.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
White.
Yes.
Stroller.
Yes. Thank you, council. Item 12, consider appointment of member to the Perry Planning Commission for the vacancy position due to Larry Belk's resignation. Larry, under the tab number 12, there is a letter of resignation from Larry. I would actually like to ask the council if we could table this until we do some research and find someone that could help us with that position.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Calderon.
Yes.
Bond.
Yes.
Ahern.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
White.
Yes.
Stroller.
Yes. Thank you, council. Item 13. Consider approval of application for payment number 4 in the amount of $94,622.79 to North Central Construction for sewer line replacement project, with the payment such amount specifically contingent upon receipt by NOTA of all the payment logs, proof of payment of all benefit pursuant to the Davis-Bacon Act, and all other required records. There's a letter here from NOTA that you all received, Dixie passed out earlier. There's some documents that the contractor has not provided for NOTA at this point. So they're asking us, management is asking us to go ahead and approve this, but it's contingent upon NOTA receiving all the proper documentation that they need.
Also, it was explained to me today that I asked it if this was final and that sewer line project was done. And I guess it's very important to use correct terminology. The project is on delay of completion due to the time of year. They need to do a little bit of finished grade dirt work and put sod down, and they can't do that being in the winter. So it's when spring comes that they'll come in and regrade it and put sod down and finish that all up. Correct?
Correct, and the grant doesn't expire until next August, so we've got plenty of time to do that.
So we'd entertain a motion to approve that contingent upon NOTA receiving all the proper documentation from North Central.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Calder.
Yes.
Bond.
Yes.
Ahern.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
White.
Yes.
Strother.
Yes, thank you. Item 14, approved payment of $446.25 to MKEC for time spent providing answers to construction questions. Larry, you have anything you want to say about that? I'm assuming it's just questions that you've had for MKC or a member of your staff.
Right, yeah. We have a number of projects out there that we're looking at, and sometimes this is just something they haven't built as far yet, that it's been completed, but they haven't built as far.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Calder.
Yes.
Bond.
Yes.
Ahern.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
White.
Yes.
Strother.
Yes. Item 15, approved payment to Monsoon Consultant in the amount of $2,100, $1,230, and $750 for engineering services rendered to date. Probably just about the same thing, just little projects we've had, and Blaine has provided engineering on that we need to get him paid.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Calder.
Yes.
Bond.
Yes.
Ahern.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
White.
Yes.
Strother.
Yes. Thank you. Item number 16, I'll go ahead and read it. Consider approval of resolution number 2019-10, authorizing participant in the OMAG recognition program. Again, we don't have the proper number of council people here to approve this. So I will ask for a motion to table this for now, but I do want to again say how important it is to try to get everybody here, because tonight we've had several emergencies that we couldn't pass. Now we have to publish them. And also this project has to be approved by all council people. So motion to table.
Is that a motion?
Yes.
Okay.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Calder.
Yes.
Bond.
Yes.
Ahern.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
White.
Yes.
Yes. Item 17, any new business needs to come before the council this evening. Item 18.
Motion adjourned.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Calder.
Yes.
Bond.
Yes.
Ahern.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
White.
Yes.
Strother.
Yes. Thank you, council.